Hallelujah. Go sing the first quirky song. Come and go with me to my Father's house. To my Father's house.
Come and go with me to my Father's house. To my Father's house. To my Father's house. Come and go with me.
Now that she breaks, we'll be a little brother. kan gebore en lief hê
soos hy.
Oh,
I want to take you again to the life of King David. The Lord takes me to his life back and back and back again. It is no wonder that the Bible says that the King of the New Jerusalem, the humanly King, will be King David. This man lived such a life, was rejected by his own family, stumped upon, cursed by Goliath. When I was lying in my bed, tossing to and fro, back and forth, couldn't sleep, these words kept hammering in my conscience. The rejection of men drew me closer to God. And I started to think about David's life. Remember, all the young ones, I'm going to ask questions later if you pay attention. It'll be a test. I would much rather speak in my birth tongue, Afrikaans, but because of you, I'm doing this in English. And I love doing it for you, but pay attention. If I see one that's not listening, I'm going to ask the person next to you to reach out and pinch you. By the way, reach out and attempt to pinch, but don't pinch yet, all right? Shandri, your brother's next to you. If he doesn't pay attention, you just, you know, clip him around and hear something.
Watch it.
How many of you think that sometimes mom and dad is unfair? Ah, the young ones, I see you raise your hand. Now I'm going to ask the adults. How many of you, thinking back of your own life, felt your parents were unfair? I thought the same. I thought my family was the worst thing next to brown bread.
Yeah.
You know, when you're young, you're cheeky, you don't appreciate, and you say terrible things. There's a couple of instances. Once, I was drunk, and I was about 18 years old, and I came home I won't say the word, it's a bit rude, but there was a pub in South Africa in the old days, and I came home, and I had my parka on, my St. West bike, with the vier keer achterop, yeah? And all these salco and the geweer badges, rof. I think it's rof, but that's it, erg rof. And come out by the place, and I showed up on the farm, and I was under the influence of the alcohol. My dad just looked at me. He didn't say a word. But the disappointment in his eyes was enough to chastise me for life. Because I was raised better. We all make mistakes. And you feel rejected from your friends when you don't fit in. And up to this very day, I pay the price of Pentecost. Me and my family. Something happened, in fact, in the week that just passed. Jack, we will pay the price of Jesus Christ as long as we live. They will tell us off. They will mock you. They will slander the Van der Waal family name. But you know what? Did Christ not say, if you endure, you will rule with him? In Afrikaans, het die Heer nie gesê, as hulle die meester van die huis my aanval, sal hulle jou nie aanval. People reject you. But it's not about what people think about you, it's what God knows about you. I want you to repeat after me. Say, it is not what people think about me, but it is what God knows about me that matters. And I grew up and I thought once I was angry at my mom. My mom, she doesn't look like she's got a red hair, but there is a taint of red in it. And my mom doesn't dye her hair. The Lord blessed her with youth and she's very pretty. And when I was young, I was very stubborn. And one morning, she was making, I won't refer, well, while you're here, Cyril, she was making her sandwiches. And Cyril probably, again, didn't know what he wanted on his bread, and he upset Mom. And then Mom had a go at me, and I had a go at Mom back. And I remember there was something wrong with my shirt. And in frustration, this is me, hey? You think I'm an angel? Well, I wasn't. I ripped the shirt buttons off, threw it back at Mom, and said, "Stitch that up." How arrogant. All the young ones, does it remind you of something? Who of the young ones made up your bed this morning? Raise your hand. I'm serious. Raise your hand higher. Can somebody just give him a medal?
Yes.
Where did you make your bed?
No.
Paulie?
No.
Walter's, yours is definitely still in ruins. You know, and is it my job to make up your bed?
No. Yeah.
To pick up your smelly socks?
No.
Yes.
No. I'll just say this, there is a grounding involved after the service. But you know, a mother and a father sees you growing up. But you also see the promise in your children. I looked at the life of King David and realized something. I always thought King David had a rude dad. Why do I say that? Remember when the prophet Samuel came and he was invited for dinner. What was David's father's name? Do you know, Steve? Let Mom tell you.
Jesse.
Say it out loud.
Jesse.
Isai. I think you pronounce it. How do you pronounce it? Isai.
Isaac?
Okay.
Isaac?
No,
Isaac.
No,
Isai. Isai. Isai.
Isaiah.
And David's dad, all the big brothers, Eliab, he had some big, strong brothers. When Samuel came, yes, David? That's right.
Jesse only showed the big, strong ones, and then Samuel asked, "Is there any other ones?" And then Jesse said, "Yeah, there's a shepherd of them."
Yeah, I can see the sons of, the Bible does say the sons of Jesse. Maybe there's a bit of a translation. I can't see his side, but I think that you're right. English does say the sons of Jesse. Hmm. And what he said is, when Samuel came, he invited David's father and everyone a place at the table, but not David. Have you ever felt that your family has done the wrong thing by? I'm not just asking the young ones. I'm asking you to think back this morning. You can't cure a wound if you don't open it up. What reason would there possibly be for David's father to leave him out in the field? You know, Mom and Dad, at night, before you go to bed, I often see my children, they go and pour a glass of milk. And you got the privilege of taking that glass of milk and putting it on your bedside table. David's brothers had the privilege, when they went to bed, they had their father with them. He could pray for them. Maybe they had fresh milk. He could give it to them. They had a bed to sleep on. They had a pillow to lie on. But what did David have? Did David's father love him less?
Yeah.
That he would send him out in the field? Lying on the ground, on the sand, using a rock or a bit of wood as his pillow. Did his father deliberately do this? Was his father harsh? And you know, I know for a fact that you think your own father sometimes was a bit hard and harsh on you. I want you to think back in your own life. And while I was in my subconscious turning on my bed, the Lord said to me, if David's father intervened in his life the way he intervened in his brother's lives, he would have spoiled David, my king. Sometimes a father sees the promise in your life. Sometimes a father sees what you can become. And a father sometimes is hard on you because he wants to mold you into the promise that he sees. If he wanted to raise a soft boy, he would have put a glass of milk on his bedside table every night. He would have gathered the firewood for them. He would have made their bed for them. But instead of doing that, he allowed his son David to be trusted by the elements outside, the weather, the rain. Many nights when David's brothers were fast asleep, their bellies full, David was still hungry. Many nights when they had their glass of milk, David still had to go lie in the old-fashioned way under one of the goats or one of the sheep and have the milk the good way, the hard way. Maybe lie on his back and just chug it in. Right? Isn't that a better way anyway? Late at night when they were safe in their father's house, David's brothers, David was alone in the field. And he heard the footsteps. A lion was stalking David. A bear was stalking the sheep. And David had to get up while his brothers were fast asleep with full bellies and warm blankets around their shoulders. But his father pushed him out in the cold and he had to fight for his life. But through the rejection, he felt his own family and men placed on him. It drew him closer to God. Because when the lion came out and ripped one of the sheep away, the first time David saw it, it probably happened. The second time and the tenth time, it probably happened. But when, as time went on, he started to make himself a weapon, a slingshot. He started to be brave. He started to trust in God. And the next time the bear came and the lion came, David, because he practiced with his slingshot, you need to practice your faith. You need to practice through suffering. What mom and dad sometimes put you through is not to embarrass you. It's to teach you the promise of God. Because if they always intervene in your life, it would have spoiled you. There is nothing as horrible and a sore sight as a spoiled child. Nothing. When you go into the shopping centers and they throw a tantrum and they squirm like a worm on the floor, it's embarrassing for the child and parents alike. If David's father spoiled him, allowed him to have a warm blanket and a warm glass of milk every night, he never would have encountered the bears and the lions out there. The rejection of men will draw you closer to God. Can all the Pentecostal kids raise their hands? Pentecost means the outcast of the Holy Spirit when it fell from heaven. Can all the Pentecost kids raise your hands? You are all Pentecost kids. Can you raise your hands? You will be hated by this world because you believe in Christ. You will be rejected by society because you believe in Jesus. But the rejection of your surroundings and of men will push you closer to God. Because you cannot rely, Walter and Paul cannot rely on my faith and my salvation. You have to find your own. You cannot allow yourself to grow up and have a relationship with God because of mom and dad. You need to find your own relationship with God. It's a personal thing. And David found his own relationship with the Lord. In one day, he heard that Samuel was coming to dinner. Yet his father didn't call for him. Why? Did his father really think he wasn't good enough? Maybe not. Maybe his father just knew if he called David because of his spirit, because of his fighting spirit, he was strong in faith. He was good looking. The Bible says he was reddish and he was quite attractive. The other boys were jealous of his appearance. Maybe his dad thought if I call him, then it will be too easy for Samuel to pick him. But if I don't call him, and it's God's will, I won't intervene in God's work. God will allow him to come to the table. And it happened. All the sons of Jesse went past Samuel, and he picked none of them. Because God don't look to your stature and your appearance. We all come in funny shapes and sizes. Short ones, round ones, thin ones, long ones, fat boys. Young, can you please stand up? Paulie, go and stand near you. Young ladies, stand up. All the young ones, stand up. Say after me, God made me. Unto his image.
Unto his image.
And I'm proud. Amen. Look at the differences.
Voor
al papies, né? Kijk dan. Jan is net mooi kop en half langer as Paulkie. Né? Is daar 'n verskil in hart? Nee. The Lord made us the way we are. I mean, if Paulie and Jan were in the Garden of Eden, they would never go hungry. Because Paulie would look for the blueberries under the shrubs, and Jan would pick the apples from behind the tree. Yeah? That's right. And when Samuel came to dinner, and all the big boys and all the strong men went past, the Lord said to him, Samuel, I've chosen none of them. Put your oil, the anointing oil, down. I will anoint none of these men. None of them. They drank the warm milk by night. They didn't make up their beds, and their beds had to be made up for them. Do you know that God rewards neatness? Do you know when a man has neat faith? A man that ties his shoes. A man that picks up after himself. If you're not disciplined cleaning your room, do you want to tell me you're going to clean your heart? No. Christ was a neat man, an organized God. Your God is an organized God. Look outside at nature. And just see how the sea cleans up everything, the rubbish that's in it, it spits out. How all the waters of the world accumulates down into the oceans. God is a neat God, and he created neat young men and women to grow up into his image. And he watches you from a distance. You see, God watched David from a distance. When the lion and the bear came near, he allowed him to fight on his own accord. David was a wild stallion. My grandfather, Opa Saro, loved horses. He loved them. He was also an outcast in his family. His older brothers always threw him into the pub and he had to fight for his life. They were very harsh on him, but yet he's the one that found the Lord and became a pastor. The rejection of men will draw you closer to God. David was the same. He was the same. Samuel walked by and said, I can find none of these sons that God anoints. Have you got any more? David felt he was rejected, left out in the field. My other brothers and sisters are warm by night, I'm cold. They are fed, I'm hungry. They are protected, I'm vulnerable. And Samuel said to Jesse, go and get your son. We shall not sit down at this table until David arrives. And the Bible said when young David came in, he was the envy of his brothers. They envied him. Some of them hated him for his guts, the way that he challenged. He was a wild stallion. If you catch a wild horse and you tame it, you have to break its spirit. You can put a saddle on a wild stallion, but you will prevent him from running free. David's brothers were tamed horses, like tamed horses. David was the wild stallion. Sometimes, if you look in your own life, you see a little bit of that there. If you put a rope around the neck of a wild stallion and you catch him, you have to force him because he will rear up on his hind legs. But you will spoil him just because you want to ride him. Because that wild stallion is probably the one that looks after the herd of horses. He protects them. When the puma and the bear and the lion comes along, the big horse rears up and with his hooves he comes stomping down. David was exactly like that. Because God says of David, I looked at him down from heaven, my son that wasn't spoiled. I looked at him and he learned to be tough. His brothers rejected him, but he drew closer to me. I looked at him and look how well he looked after the flock of sheep. He was a wild stallion. What you go through in your life will form you, will mold you. The fact that mom and dad sometimes is hard on you doesn't mean they don't love you. It actually means they love you more because they see your potential and they don't want to spoil you. Because when dad lays his head down and he's not there anymore, how are you going to fend for yourself and fight for yourself if you haven't learned to do it? A wild stallion comes to the water. A stallion has to drink as well. But it comes at night when no one sees. The water of God, the Holy Spirit, reigns in the wild stallions amongst us as well. I was wild. In my heart I am still wild. I'm different. I know it. If you give me a chance, I'll be out in the bush. Not any bush, the wild bush. Because I'm always looking. I remember the times when I walked through the bush and I encountered a leopard and her cub, and I was almost killed. I was on the brink of death, but God saved me. that little bit of wildness in your heart. If Samson wasn't wild, like a wild stallion, he wouldn't have meant nothing for God. But because he was wild at heart, he wasn't a spoiled boy. He wasn't a spoiled girl. You think your parents are hard on you? Look at Samson. He was a cast out. Yet, when over 1,000 Philistines confronted him, that wild man grabbed the jawbone of a donkey. And his hand, the Bible says, his hand latched onto it. And he defeated them all. When David showed up after he was anointed at that dinner by Samuel, his brothers started hating him. Later on, when he showed up on the battlefield with some bread and some cheese to give his brothers food, and Goliath was standing there, no one had the courage to go and attack and fight against Goliath. Why did David have the courage? Can you give the credit to him alone? No, you have to give the credit to his father, the one who seemed to reject his son. Makes me think about Christ. God had all the time in the world to intervene. When his son was carrying the old rugged cross, and the angels of heaven were on the brink, Gabriel, Michael, they couldn't bear it anymore. And God pulled the sackcloth over the sun. He prevented the sun from shining. But God did not intervene because he would not spoil his son, Jesus Christ. He needed Jesus to do this on his own. Similarly, when David went to Goliath, and Saul put all the armor. Sometimes you feel like life is just loading you up with all these responsibilities. And it's getting heavier and heavier. And David was but a boy. But Saul said, no, you got to carry this big sword, man. And you got to carry all this armor. All the pressure of society was on him. And you know what he did? He ripped it off and said, no. When I was alone in the field, King Saul, and the bear attacked me, and the lion attacked me, God was with me. And this Philistine who is cursing God, this uncircumcised Philistine, I will defeat him and bring you his head in the name of the Lord my God of hosts. And David walked forward that day, while his brothers were watching. In the eyes of his family, he was a traitor. Have you ever felt? I'm going to step on some toes this morning. I'm going to pinch some nerves until that wound is open. Have you ever felt that your parents disadvantaged you amongst your brothers and sisters? Have you ever felt your sister got more than you? Have you ever felt your brother got more than you and you got less? I have. But it doesn't mean I'm right. Or maybe my dad saw something in me that I would be standing one day here preaching to you and become a pastor. But if I haven't been out in the wilderness and suffered and felt rejected, I never would have became what I am today. My dad went to 14 schools. Had to look after his brothers and sisters while my grandma and grandpa was on the road preaching the gospel. In his own words, opened the fridge many times, let alone have a fridge. There was nothing. Had to raise his young siblings. Like 12, 14 kilometers, something silly. He had to ride on his bike, walk. He didn't have a bike. And then one of the people in church bought him a bushwhack. God looked after him. My mother here. My father, grandfather was a blacksmith. She blowed the bellow off the fire and saw him hit on the anvil late at night. Mom did it because she wanted to do it. Made her strong. When she stood on the corner of the streets, playing accordion from 8 years old. And the people sometimes mocked her family. It must have hurt. The rejection of men drew her closer to God. I found a depth in God because I felt rejected. David walked onto the battlefield. In the eyes of his family, he was a traitor, but not in the eyes of his father. His father believed in him. You read about his brothers chastising him, but not about his father. He saw there was a promise, there was a king in the making here. Oh, God must have been so proud. Goliath said, "Am I a dog that you come to me with your wooden staff and your slingshot?" He goes, "Come here, boy. I'll rip you apart and feed your flesh to the heavens." Pentecost children will always be attacked by society. But guess what? Greater is he that is within me than he that is in the world. You've got the best of the best. My grandfathers both gave me the best of the best, not in money-wise, but in heart and in spirit. Yes, and I didn't have it easy. I've got the privilege of having my father here today. And let me tell you, he didn't raise me easy. But he raised me to be a man. And now that I'm older, I understand a lot of things so clear, so much better. You didn't want to spoil me, then I wouldn't appreciate. "Am I a dog," Goliath said, "that you come to me with your shepherd's staff and your slingshot?" The Philistines mocked him and said, "You're a boy, you're going to die." They saw a boy, his brother saw a traitor. But David's father saw promise, and God in heaven saw king. And you know the history, and Goliath came nearer, and David took one of those rocks. And he thought to himself, "If it's the last thing I'll do, I'll take you down. You cursed my God." You see, it takes a wild stallion to stand up on his back legs and rear up. Because he wasn't spoiled, David could fight. I'm hoping you'll understand your parents a bit better after today. And for those of you that's mom and dad might have been passed away, I want you to think back and see. Many times they just didn't want to spoil you, and they raised you and made you what you are today. David started swinging that slingshot. The Bible says he threw it that hard, that straight. It whistled through the air, found a little gap between Goliath's forehead and his eyes, and the rock penetrated his skull. And he fell down with a mighty roar in front of a young boy they saw as selfish. Of a young boy, Goliath said, "Am I a dog that you come to me like this?" Of a young boy, but God saw him as a king. Mom, can you please play? When God was talking to me Friday night, I saw many of you. In fact, I've got some prophecies for a lot of you. Because the Lord God gave it to me. Can all the young people please stand? Can you come to the front, in fact, and hold hands? Thank you. Just stand in a circle. Morty, you can hold your cousin's hand. It's all right. Shabri, stand your hands under me. And on the other hand, stand your hands, Shabri. That's it, and I'll put your hands in the bar. All right, hold your hands. Give mom and dad his heart on you. Today is Father's Day. Look over to your dad. I want you to look to your dad. Don't look away from him. Keep looking to your dad. Keep looking at him. Think about the times you thought he was unfair. And then you think about this message. You think, ah, he's a bit hard on me. Does he love me? Not sure. Oh, yes, he does. Like God the Father didn't intervene when Jesus was crucified. Just like that. If he always intervenes and lets you do what you want, he will spoil you. And you won't have the strength to fight the Goliaths in your heart. You're young. You are the future of this congregation. And when I... in my subconscious, Friday night, and the Lord spoke to me. In my dreams, I wasn't really awake. I saw the young people of this congregation as strong pillars. And the Lord said to me, he's molding you. I saw the cast of a pillar. Do you know what a cast is? Yeah. If you break your arm, they put a cast. But you know how they make pillars?
Yeah.
They make a mold, and they cast. The Lord is busy casting you into strong men, into strong women. If you endure, if you are patient, if you are selfish, it won't work. If David ran out of the field and said, I'm not doing this anymore, why are the other brothers not working? They are sleeping in their beds. I have to watch the sheep. How many times do you hear that? I say to Walter and Paulie, go get some wood. The first thing they say, you do it, you do it. I want that to change. I want you in your heart to think about King David. If you want the better end of God's promise in your life, a lot of you have to work for God. Shandu, it's you. It's you. Yeah. It's you. Walton, it's you. Stephen, it's you. Nicholas, it's you. Zander, it's you. DeAndre, it's you. Anari, it's you. Paul, it's you. If you want to work for God, if you want to mean something for God, you have to allow the Lord to chastise you in your own life. Now look back to your mom and dad. Do you think they had it easy? Do you think their parents just let them have an easy upbringing? We got a lot more buckslaw than yellow. But it made us men and women. It made us strong. If you feel a little bit wild, if you feel a little bit restless, if you feel like I don't really fit in, you're just a man and woman God wants. If you feel your past is a little bit tainted, your past is a little bit stained, you're the man and woman God wants. You're the one God can use, because nothing you've got came easy, came the hard way. And that's why you hang on to it. Sometimes, Alicia, we have to fight in life for what we know is wrong, is right. And the Lord puts something in us, a little bit of spice, a little bit of gum, and you go for it. You've got it. You don't have to wonder, have I got it? you've got the blessings of generations on your shoulders. You will make it far, far better. You'll be prosperous. You'll be blessed. You'll be the head and not the tail. I feel the presence of my Father in this room. It's been here right from the start. Don't know if you know this, but it's been here all along. Men that go to the army can't obey if you don't break their will. Want to go to the army? They will break your will, otherwise you won't obey. Although Hitler was a very bad and vicious man, he had a great army. One of his rules: if you can't obey, don't be here. God's army works the same. If you can't obey mom and dad, don't be here. If you can't obey God's law, the Lord God says, my son, I will chastise you because I love you. I've said enough, I've said plenty. Just close your eyes, please. The rejection of men drew me closer to you, Father. While you were hanging on the cross, Lord, one moment the sun was shining, the next moment darkness fell for 3 hours on the hill of Golgotha all over the world. Although it was impossible for a solar eclipse to take place because it was full moon, it was impossible. Yet the sun went down. Lord Jesus, and you cried out and you said these words, Father, 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 why have you forsaken me? Every single one of us in this congregation have asked and uttered those words to our earthly fathers and mothers. Why have you forsaken me? Why are you so unfair? Why are you so harsh on me? Why don't I get it easy? Why don't I get more pocket money? What's wrong? Why can't you buy me a new car that like all the rich kids in school or things like that? But Jesus, because you felt rejected on the cross by men, it actually drew you nearer to your Father. And when you died and you exhaled your last breath, you said the words, Father, why have you forsaken me? But in your hands I utter now, and I give my spirit. And when you came into heaven, with your blood-stained hands, Lord Jesus, the Father said, now, because you earned it the hard way, and didn't call on the angels of heaven to come and rescue you from the cross, or to destroy all the men and women on earth, because you earned it, Christ, the hard way and the true way. Now, you come and sit on my right hand. Here is your throne. Here is your crown. Now you rightfully bought the souls of every man and woman that ever sinned on this very earth and shall ever sin. You've got the right to forgive their sins and to wash it away with your blood, because you were rejected, but yet you conquered. Father, I want to pray this very morning for every man and woman and child, for every young person in this congregation. You believe in them. You believe in them. No matter what they went through in life, you pushed them through those things because you believed in them. I want you now to walk past every single one of them and let them feel your love, your presence. Touch our hearts, Lord Jesus, now. Father, in your presence now. Please, Lord. Every single one. When the Father hugs his children, those few seconds you spent on the chest of your dad, it's nothing like it. You feel so secure, so warm. You don't get a lot of it. If you got too many of it, then you wouldn't appreciate it. But just those few small seconds, you realize, yes, that's my dad. Thank you, Father. Father in heaven, for giving us that love now. Every single one of us. Thank you for restoring today. Heartaches and pain that maybe came a long way. Thank you that grown men and women can today forgive their parents after this message. Thinking back, yes, maybe mom and dad had the best intentions in heart and they just wanted to push me to my limits so I can be strong one day. Like a wild horse running free for God's work, rearing up at the lions and the bears around me, learning how to protect the flock like David did. And for many years after, King David reared up like a wild horse. And when he came down, he devoured all the nations around him, the Philistines, the Moabites. Nobody stood in front of King David because he was wild at heart. God allowed it to be so. Amen.